One big advantage here from China is the long-term approach.
I think that what that shift showed was that this, it was an organization with deep roots in Chinese society.
One big advantage here from China is the long-term approach. In Europe, we have elections every 4 years, and sometimes, you know, a new government comes in, some changes might be announced, and in the second year, slowly changes are happening. In the third year, we already think about the next election. In the fourth year, everything is kind of, you know, being stopped because the next election is coming in. So I prefer actually the long-term approach in the Chinese fashion. It's good to have a strong party in power where you can have this long-term approach. And maybe we are too short-term oriented back in Europe and back in the US. It's actually a so-called Anglo-Saxon approach. It's arm's length decision-making where we only think about shareholder value and short-term returns. In China, we got the principle of long-term return and giving back to society. And I think the Chinese government is embracing this principle.
I think one of the most interesting things about the Chinese Communist Party historically was after Mao died, because the country was in trouble. And what happened was that Deng Xiaoping, as he emerged as a new leader, really made a big shift in the outlook and philosophy. Now, if I look around the world, it's very unusual to see political organizations, political parties, making that kind of shift, because they become captured by their own prejudices and values. And it's very difficult for them to start thinking in different ways to make that kind of shift. It requires a lot of courage and it requires a lot of confidence. And I think that what that shift showed was that this, it was an organization with deep roots in Chinese society. You know, because you've got to basically reject a lot of the kind of ideology you've had, and you've got to reach out to people in a different kind of way. So I think that example shows you that, unlike, for example, the Soviet Communist Party, which I think didn't have deep roots in Russian society.
And, you know, in the course of a short interview like this, I cannot possibly go into the many reasons that have been put forth for this success. But, you know, in my modest opinion, after 2 years being here, I would identify two factors as being particularly important in this regard. One of them is to strike an adequate balance between the role of the market, the role of supply and demand on the one hand, and the role of public policy, the role of government on the other. It's a very fine equilibrium. Many countries go either to one extreme, to let the market do as it pleases, or to have the state being extremely proactive. And it seems to me that what China has done is to find a nice balance between these two elements. The other factor that I've been able to ascertain in my travels around China, I visited about 20 provinces in these 2 years that I've been here. My goal is to visit all 32 by the time my time is up, is this incrementalist, experimental approach to public policy that is to try out something first in a province or in a city, and then expand this to the rest of the country. So in such a way, you avoid the mistakes of launching policies that may be bound for failure. And if you launch them nationwide, it will be a real disaster. But if you try them out in some place, say as the opening was tried out in Shenzhen in the early 80s, then if it works out, you can expand it to other other places. Now, the expression, if I'm not mistaken, from Mr. Deng Xiaoping is to cross the river while feeling the stones.